Resh Hour with yours truly, Reshma Raghunath. I'm pleased to welcome tonight a very special guest. Always a pleasure to have him here with us at the Resh Hour, Governor Martyn Roper. And incidentally, Governor Roper, it's the final episode for 2021, so we're ending with a bang.
Well, thank you very much, Reshma. It's always a pleasure to be here, and I think I did come and do your first show as well.
That is correct.
And congratulations to you on a year of your show. And I know
thank
this
you.
Has become a feature of the Cayman media scene over the last year. So congratulations on
thank
everything
you.
You've done.
I appreciate that. Thank you so much. So we have lots to talk about. There have been so many things happening in Cayman Islands. Last night was a very busy night. You had a very busy morning this morning. Yeah. I understand you did a special swearing in. You want to tell us a little bit about that?
Yes, so, I think as everybody knows, Honourable Dwayne Seymour MP has joined the government, so under the Constitution I have to formally give him a letter of appointment. He's been made a Parliamentary Secretary, and I think he'll have responsibility for working with three of the ministries, Housing, Labour, and what was the other one?
Transportation.
Transportation as well. So, yes, this morning he came to my office. I gave him a letter of appointment, and that's sort of required under the Constitution. But I congratulate him on his appointment. I look forward to working with him, and I wish him every success. And I'll continue to work closely with the government on their ambitious agenda.
I know you don't tend to delve into local politics, but were you surprised by that? The shift in...
It, as you say, Reshma, that's not really a matter for me. That is a matter for the Premier and his government, and my role is to ensure that everything is done properly in line with the Constitution, which absolutely it was in this case. And it's happened before. It's not the first time that a member has crossed to the other side. So good luck to Parliamentary Secretary Seymour.
Always the diplomat. All right, so let's talk about stuff that you can talk about now. Yep. and have an opinion on that you can, share with us. There are other developments happening internationally and, of course, that have significant bearing here on the Cayman Islands. And I'm specifically talking about the new variant, the COVID variant, Omicron.
Yep.
So, a lot is still pretty much up in the air, but a lot of people are concerned about the variants and its implications for the Cayman Islands, travel, that kind of thing. Have you had discussions around those, those travel concerns and what's happening with our own local borders?
I mean, I have had, obviously, discussions with people here in Cayman, but I've also spoken quite a bit to the UK about their assessment of what's happening with Omicron. I mean, obviously, we need to wait for information, and everyone, I think, is clear on that. And there is some concern that it may be more infectious. There is some concern it may have an impact on vaccines. I think what I've been told by the UK, who is obviously listening very closely to UK scientists, is that I think it is highly likely that there could be some impact on the effectiveness of vaccines. But I think the most plausible scenario is that the vaccines will still work, and the vaccines will still prevent you from becoming seriously ill or even worse, dying. And I think that is something that we don't know for definite yet. That's the key point. But the scientists that the UK has spoken to and the advice that's been given to us is that is a plausible outcome, which would clearly be good news. But I think what this really underlines again is the need for everyone to get vaccinated, and particularly the boosters. I mean, I'm really pleased to say that yesterday we had another delivery from the UK of 8,000 vaccines. I'm really pleased with UK support on vaccines. I think it's the eighth delivery we've had to Cayman, which was the first actually to get the vaccines. And what we can now do is follow what the UK is doing on boosters, because the UK has decided that the best defence against this new variant is to get boosters into people's arms. So anyone over 18, as of next Monday, in the Cayman Islands can get their booster, and the gap from your second dose has been reduced to 3 months. So if you had your second dose 3 months ago, you can now come forward and get a booster. And I would strongly recommend that people get that booster, because if there is some reduction in the effectiveness of the vaccines on immunity levels, it's the booster that builds that back up. So that's your that's your best protection.
Now, we know that the research is still out on that in terms of the level of how sick people get. What's the feeling like for you and within government when you are discussing, say, changes to the border reopening plan or restrictions? Because we are seeing around the world, countries are looking at locking down borders again. I think there some countries I've read are implementing quarantine once again for international travelers. To what extent are we looking at those kinds of changes here?
I mean, I think obviously Dr. Lee and the medical experts are advising government every hour, almost every couple of hours, on what our response should be. But we're in a sort of a wait and see moment now, and we've been told by the experts internationally that within, we hope, a couple of weeks of when we first heard of this new variant, we would get some more clarity on that point about how infectious and that point about how much the vaccine impact might wane. So we're waiting for that, and I think government is very conscious that we need that information really before we can take further decisions about where we go next. But we already have checks and balances in place. The lateral flow tests that are being done now extensively across the islands gives us that sort of confidence that we will be able to detect COVID. I recognise that everyone is concerned that we still have a lot of cases, and we'd all like to see those cases coming down. I think they have come down a bit. I mean, they were I think it was sort of 140 a day. It was sort of up above sort of 200 a day. So it has come down a bit. But I think the really key statistic is really not so much the cases; it's more hospitalisations. And I think on that, the latest figure I've seen is that we still have 17 people in hospital. Which is obviously a real worry and a concern, and my thoughts and prayers go to all of the people in hospital and their family and friends. But that's very low. If you look at what's happened with this pandemic across the world, that is still a very low number, and that's because the vaccines are working, and the vaccines are protecting the vast majority of people. So I think today I was told as well that of the people in hospital, 94% are unvaccinated. So one thing that this new variant does is underline again the need to get vaccinated. And if we need a statistic which tells a story, it's that you know, we have enormous coverage of vaccination in the Cayman Islands, and yet 94% of the small number of people in hospital are unvaccinated. So the real fear with this Omicron variant is that if it is more infectious and you're not vaccinated, it will find you. It will infect you. So please do get the vaccine and go for those boosters to make sure that you are as protected as possible from this terrible virus.
So we do know that we have many of our cases are Delta variant, which was initially considered one of the most infectious spreading variants. Now we know different about that with Omicron. Do you know if the tests are being run on island, the sequencing, to see if it is here already?
Yes, I think the good thing about the PCR tests can identify Omicron because we will know, and as I understand today, we have not identified any cases of this new variant in the Cayman Islands, but we will know pretty quickly if that happens, because the PCR test enables you to identify that. So we don't I think you would do genome sequencing to absolutely confirm it. But you can be pretty clear that the PCR test will help us to identify that. So that's obviously good news for us, and we have to remain vigilant. But as I say, I think the key thing for everybody is really to make sure you are as protected as possible, because if it is more infectious, there is clearly a greater risk that we might get it. But if you are vaccinated, it will avoid you getting seriously ill or worse, dying, for the vast majority of people.
Well, that's good news that you heard it here first. No cases of Omicron recorded in the Cayman Islands. So let's knock on wood and hope it stays that way. But you know, what are the next steps now as we move towards looking at phase five, and of course, in the climate that we're in, what are the next steps for government?
I mean, I think these are matters for government, and obviously there are lots of discussions underway behind the scenes. But as I sort of said just now, I think mm-hmm. the key thing is we have to wait for the information about Omicron, because that will clearly determine where all countries around the world go next in their response. I think my understanding is government is comfortable with where we are now in terms of the measures we have in place to keep the population as safe as possible, but we have to wait for that information, which hopefully we will get in the next week or so, and then be able to take further decisions. But I don't think there'll be any decisions announced until we have that information, because that's so fundamental to forming policy going forward.
Okay, so as we touch on phase five, we are a week and a half into the border reopening. November 20th was the big day that we had all been waiting for. Tell us how the reopening has been progressing, and in your assessment, how the measures that have been implemented are being followed, are working as we, you know, move into this phase.
Well, I think people are working extremely hard. I mean, Travel Cayman and the entire civil service are working very hard to implement it. There have been some teething problems over the authorizations, which is perhaps understandable with a new system and a lot more people coming in. But I do think it's a step forward for the jurisdiction that we got to 20 November, and we've been able to lift that quarantine requirement for incoming vaccinated travelers. I think we had 5,000 people in November. A third of those were sort of tourists. So it started perhaps slowly and gradually, which is what we would expect. And I think as the weeks pass, then, you know, we would hope that those numbers pick up. So I think it's proceeding. It's been taken sort of gradually. We got to 20 November and lifted that quarantine requirement.
I'm glad you touched on the teething problems, because that was something that I had on my list to ask you, because we've been getting people reaching out to us, yeah, encountering difficulties with the processing of the declarations, the interface being a bit problematic, some saying it's a bit complicated for, you know, people who are trying to just get home. Mm. What can you tell us about the system and the changes, if any, that may happen to maybe make this a little easier for residents, returning visitors, that kind of thing?
I know the team behind the scenes, you know, Wes Howard,
Chief Officer, and all his team, Travel Command, they're working incredibly hard to resolve any of the issues. I think they're moving to much more of automation, automatic responses, rather than having to do some things manually, and that will clearly speed matters up. I mean, if I can say from my own perspective, I was a traveller. I went to London for the Joint Ministerial Council. I came back, I mean, applying for my permissions, treated just like anybody else, was very straightforward in my situation. And I've done my three lateral flow tests on day two, day five, and day 10, all negative. I'm pleased to say, and I had to go to the clinic and get a card stamped, and then the clinic inform public health of the sort of negative results. So, you know, my own experience was incredibly positive. It was quick. It was smooth. It was efficient. And I think that is the experience for the vast majority of people. But there will be obviously some teething issues, which I know the teams are working really hard to sort out.
Now, we like to get the public involved here on the Resh Hour, and we do have some questions that were sent in. And I want to get to the first question. But before we get to that, I just want to touch on flights in particular. And, you know, right now we only have limited airlines coming in. How much can you share with us in terms of any increase in airlift coming to the islands that can help boost those numbers? Because 5,000 in November, we're heading into the holidays, you know, yeah, a lot of people are going to, yeah, want to come back. Yeah. Is there anything that you can tell us about
I haven't seen any further information than has already been made public, and clearly this is a matter for the Ministry of Tourism. But I think if the numbers are there of people wanting to come, then the airlines will lay on flights. So, you know, I think we always expected it to be fairly slow and gradual to start with. But it will build up. So I think we just have to take it step by step.
I know the BA flights have always been quite an attraction for many who play and watch out there. And we incidentally have a question from the public about that particular BA flight. And the question is, since the new variant is in the UK, why are flights still coming in from the UK? Can you...
The government did take some
measures to add additional restrictions for people coming from Southern Africa, where the variant first emerged. But I mean, this variant is now in so many countries across the world. So you know, you come to a point where you close the border if you start sort of stopping flights coming in. So we have to rely on the measures that we have in place. And you know, everyone coming to the Cayman Islands has to do a PCR test. So we know that they have to be negative when they go to the airport to get on the plane. And then we're doing the lateral flow testing on day 2, day 5 and day 10. So we have to rely on the measures that are in place. And I think the medical advice was that as of today, there was no reason to go beyond the steps that had been taken, and there's no, you know, reason why the BA flight shouldn't come in, and you know that is overwhelmingly safe in terms of the numbers of people that are coming in and out on that flight.
All right, now we do have to take a quick break when we come back, we're going to continue our conversation with the governor, and I want to move on to I know we talked about vaccinations, but I want to delve a little more into that on the other side of this break. So stick around. We'll be right back after this quick commercial break.
Hurricane season is here. If you're not prepared, it can really turn your life upside down. Fortunately, there's CG Britke. Our dedicated staff are here for you, ready to assist at a moment's notice. Our first priority is turning claims around as quickly as possible so you can get your life moving in the right direction. CG Britke. Good like that.
Our new print materials are here.
Great, let's see them.
Oh no.
Who is the accounting firm?
That's us, the accounting firm with a typo.
We need those fixed ASAP.
No can do, sir. They were shipped here.
Compass Media, your local printers. No shipping required. Booklets, magazines, flyers to presentation folders. Compass Media offers the widest range of print products on island, including paperback publications. Your Cayman Print Shop by Compass Media. See online, compassmedia.ky.
You have the power to control the energy you use in your home. Remember to sign up today for MyCUC to track and manage your energy, the energy you use. Here are a few tips. Set your thermostat to a comfortable temperature. Chargers for computers, phones, and iPads should not be left plugged in when not in use. Opening and closing your refrigerator door will result in more energy being used. You have the power to control what you use and what you pay.
Ourselves in providing outstanding customer service in a warm, friendly environment where patients become friends. Please visit us for your eye examination, designer frames, sunglasses, lenses, and contact lenses needs. Come in for adjustments or repairs to your glasses. Our optical laboratory can produce prescription glasses and sunglasses within an hour. Visit us at 72 Market Street, Caymana Bay, Caribbean Optical at 7 Mile Shops, and coming soon to Savannah, Visionware Cayman, Country Corner.
In this month's Cayman Compass Cold Cases Files, in partnership with the Royal Cayman Islands Police Service, we look into the 2011 murder of Jason Christian.
Jason was found with a gunshot wound to the head, and a friend of his who was seemed to be in the vehicle with him also received 4 gunshot wounds at the time. It was very terrifying because at 9, it was just after 9 during the night hours. So most people were looking either to go to bed or just sitting, relaxing with family. And there was not much that anyone actually saw based on the inquiries that we did.
You can view the full episode of this series on caymancompass.com.
Welcome back to the Resh Hour. Thank you for staying with us here. We are having our conversation with none other, Governor Martyn Roper, and we have been throwing him some hard questions, Governor. We have a few hard, tougher ones coming, but you can take it. You survived the COVID briefings with me. You can take it.
Yeah, we did 65 press briefings on the trot at one point.
Can you imagine?
It
feels like really, really long ago, honestly.
It is.
It's sort of March, April, May of last year. So it is 18 months ago, really, isn't it now?
It is. It's crazy. So, speaking of the briefings, everyone usually sends us messages when a week passes, and they haven't heard anything. What's happening with the briefings? Do you know if we're going to be having one anytime soon?
It's a matter for the Premier to sort of decide the timing of those. I think as the Premier and all
MPs are down in Parliament, there's quite a lot of debate about COVID and the response. So I think obviously the public will be getting information about this from what's been said down there. Let's see. I imagine that there will be a need for a press conference in due course, maybe when we get more information about Omicron. But at the moment, I think the Premier and his team and the MPs are very much focused on Parliament and Finance Committee.
Mm-hmm. Now, we've noticed your absence from the press briefings. Was that a deliberate move on your part?
I think it sort of reflects the fact that health is a devolved responsibility. It is for the government. And I'm very happy to be there to sort of give a UK perspective or talk about UK support. So I may appear at future press conferences if there's something particularly relevant that needs to be said from a UK perspective. But it's really for the government to sort of lead the response. And I don't think there's a need for me to be there for every single press conference, but it'll be ad hoc in the future.
All right. Now, we were talking about vaccinations earlier and boosters, and you made the point that the booster period has been recommended, shortened from 6 months from your second dose to 3 months. So, you're open to going for the boosters earlier than before. Now, are you seeing an uptick in the vaccinations, or is it kind of leveled off where the community isn't really going forward as we saw previously? I know ahead of the border reopening, we had that big jump. So are you still seeing that?
Well, it's gone up to 82%.
I mean, I think the first thing to say is we should really celebrate just what a high vaccine take-up that is. It is still one of the highest anywhere in the world. And I strongly believe it is the reason why the numbers of people in hospital are relatively low compared to what's happened in many other parts of the world. So I think it will go higher. I think 15% of the population have had a booster. So I think there's great scope for growth in the people who have their booster. And I think that would be something we would really want to see in the days and weeks to come. That now, particularly now, we've reduced the length of time from 6 months to 3 months after your second dose. We would really like to see lots more people coming forward to get that booster. But we're up to 82% first dose. I think it's 79, is it? So we're almost at 80% for both doses. I think there's still some room for it to go even higher. We could get to 85. Who knows? I think there's still growth for more people to come and get it.
All right. Now, I'm going to throw a really tough one at you here. And it has to do with the mandating of vaccinations. Mm. And we have the mandates for the work permit holders. And I know this was raised previously at the last press briefing. But what is happening with the mandating vaccinations for contracted government workers? What can you tell me about the discussions or any sort of timeline when this may actually take place?
Well, that is something that the Deputy Governor is leading on, and work is underway to bring that in, and I think it needs to come to Cabinet. But that is that is progressing. I mean, my concern, if I'm being honest, is that it's our front line, workers, whether it's at the airport, whether it's at the prison as well. Mandating vaccines is a difficult thing to do, but I actually believe that testing of people is something that we have a right to expect as well, whether it's PCR testing or lateral flow testing, because we do run a risk if a lot of our frontline people are not vaccinated. So all of this is under discussion, I think you will see that come forward in due course, but I haven't got a specific date just now, but it is under discussion in government.
Mm-hmm. And building on that, because we are experiencing a spike in cases, I think the latest figure that we have that was as of last night that was shared with us from public health was we had 3,936 active cases, and the total number of cases since the pandemic started was 7,235. Now, we did see a sharp increase in such a short space of time. I mean, what are your thoughts on how we transitioned so quickly, and your advice for the public?
The advice is to continue to wear masks, to continue to socially distance, to continue to look after your own sort of basic hygiene. And I think, perhaps in contrast to what we see in the UK at the moment, I think people in Cayman are being extremely responsible. I think that, the overwhelming majority of people are wearing masks where they're asked to wear masks, and that is really, really positive. I know that it's a lot of cases, and we obviously want to get that down. But again, I think if you take the proper precautions to protect yourself, getting the vaccine, following all the basic health guidance, then you personally are managing the risk to yourself and your family, and that's the best to do. And if you do that, we can continue to go to restaurants and visit family, provided we take the proper precautions. But once you start getting the sort of community spread that we've had, it probably is going to take a bit of time for that. Other countries, we've looked closely at what Bermuda, and it did that. Theirs level stayed high for quite some time, but theirs have now dropped. I think that will happen for us as well. But again,
especially now that we're heading into the holiday season, everyone is going to want to go hang out with their family.
Yeah.
People are going to be coming back, traveling. It is key to follow those regulations and the examples that we've all learned to live with, right? And honestly, it's become a normal wearing a mask. Just as it can be sometimes, honestly, especially if you're trying to run upstairs to the studio with half an hour to go. But, these are the things that have helped us
move. They do. And mask wearing is important because it's not foolproof, but it does offer some protection for both yourself and other people. And I think that there is now evidence that wide-scale wearing of masks will reduce the amount of infection that's spreading in the community. So, I
say thank you to people in our community for behaving responsibly and wearing masks when we ask them to do so.
Yeah, that's one good thing about us. We can
exactly.
We can count on
exactly.
Cayman to come together for the community.
Yeah.
I want to switch gears a little now from COVID, because there are other things happening in the world. And you recently returned from the UK.
Yeah.
You were part of the Joint Ministerial Council meeting. I think it was the first time in the in-person meeting
in three years.
So, tell us about that. What was it like being there in the whole environment changing from COVID to transition back to actual in-person meetings with other OT leaders?
Sure. I mean, the first thing you noticed about the UK
is that it does feel very different. I mean, they have sort of moved on from COVID in many ways. I mean, you don't see many people wearing masks. The bars and the restaurants look as busy as they normally are. So I think there has been a sort of a mental shift from people in the UK that, we have to live with this. And You know, that was certainly one impression. The meeting itself, I think, was very good. It was very positive meeting, good atmospherics, and we had the Prime Minister giving a video message. The Duke of Cambridge came in and spoke to overseas territories leaders about climate change, particularly. We had a new minister, Amanda Milling, who's the Minister for the Overseas Territories. The Foreign Secretary, Liz Truss, recently appointed as well, came in. So it was a very strong demonstration by the UK that the Overseas Territories were a really valued part of the UK family. And I think from the Overseas Territories side, there was a desire to sort of almost reset the relationship after Brexit, after COVID, but there was also huge recognition of what the UK has done on vaccines. I think that was everybody was incredibly grateful at how quickly the UK had provided vaccines to the overseas territories. I was told yesterday that we've sent out over 70 vaccine deliveries to across six continents to some of our far-flung overseas territories, and not one has been lost, which is a pretty amazing achievement. Of course, we've had I think eight or nine deliveries. So the meetings were very good. I think that we talked obviously a lot about climate change. Minister Ebanks, who represented the Premier, who had been in the UK the two weeks earlier at the Glasgow COP conference, mm-hmm. Minister Ebanks did a very good job, represented Cayman extremely well. I think it was a good set of meetings. I hope very much the minister will come and visit us in 2022. She's very keen to come to Cayman. I think we will get more visitors next year than we've had in the last 18 months. In fact, Foreign Secretary Liz Truss said that she wants to visit as many of the overseas territories as she can. So we may even get a visit by the Foreign Secretary. So it was a good set of meetings.
All right. Sounds good to me. So what were some of the main areas that were discussed in the Joint Ministerial Council? I know COVID would have featured heavily. What can you tell us, if any, what policies were outlined, that kind of thing?
Sure. I mean, COVID did feature heavily. I think, again, there was that discussion about vaccine provision. But I think there was a sense coming through from the overseas territories that they want to have a reset in the relationship. Now, the overseas territories were pushing for a new white paper, which is how governments sort of set out policy in an area. UK ministers were not that keen to go down the white paper route because it can take a long time. But what Minister Milling did say was that she wanted to see action over the next year. And a bit like we've done on vaccines, where the UK has provided really sort of terrific support, she invited overseas territories leaders to set out what sort of areas of support, technical or otherwise, they would like from the UK over the next year. So she'll be writing to Premier Panton to ask him to respond to her. We spent a lot of time on COP26, looking back at the results of the Glasgow conference. And again, I think there was a sense coming through that this is an area where the UK and the overseas territories can work together closely, because the UK would certainly like, I know the OTP's territories want this, to be, you know, a role model for sort of good performance in seeking to meet the targets that we've all set to try and keep temperature rise as low as possible. And so, you know, Cayman, we've got the marine parks, we've got this new fund, the Climate Change Finance Fund, the Commonwealth Fund. Cayman's got ambitious targets on renewable energy. I know the Premier is very keen to look at the sort of the development plan. So I think that there's real ambition from Cayman to make a step change in this area in the months and years to come. And I'm just very keen and pleased that the UK is at Cayman's side and will support, as we have been doing in a number of areas already.
And additionally, I mean, it is very significant for us as a small island, climate change, and we're seeing the effects of it on our beaches as well. 7 Mile Beach, we've seen the erosion that is happening, and that's why it kind of presses home the message of how important addressing these issues are, especially when it comes to small islands like ours. I also want to touch on the UK-funded exercise that was happening here, that kind of is part of the UK funding initiative, the mapping of the seabed.
Yes.
That was a very novel exercise for us here in Cayman.
Yeah.
And it was, of course, through the UK assistance. So tell us a little about that project, because there have been questions about whether the UK is searching for oil. So
it's got absolutely nothing to do with that. And if there was any oil, it would be Cayman's oil, or it would be the Overseas Territories oil.
No, this is a really important exercise. It's not just for Cayman, it is for all the overseas territories. I think there was some data for Cayman, but it's very old and it needs to be updated. And this will just give us really up-to-date, accurate data, which can help in a whole range of different areas. So one specific example would be this data will help hazard management do storm surge modelling. And that's really important for managing sort of future disasters. So this is a really useful exercise, and we're going to get the data very quickly, and it's for Cayman, which will own the data, and it's for Cayman to decide how to use it. So we set up a UK Cayman partnership agreement on environment and climate change, and this was one of the projects within that. So I'm very pleased we've been able to do it.
As you touched on hazard management, we passed a significant milestone yesterday. Hurricane season is over.
Yeah.
Everybody take a deep breath.
Absolutely.
So, you know, just your thoughts on the hurricane season. I know you were actively part of the hurricane season preparedness push, as well as, you know,
yes,
your involvement with the helicopter, the RCIPS helicopter services, as well the air operations unit, who also provide significant support, the regiment as well.
Yes.
You know, your thoughts on the hurricane season in the past and how we
prepared. You and everybody else, obviously relieved that we've got through the hurricane season. We did have, of course, a tropical storm, which most people tell me was a hurricane, actually. I mean, given the amount of damage it did to trees.
It did feel like a hurricane. Debate is still open. Don't open that kind of worms.
But we know we have had, I think we've had, what, three tropical storms over the last couple of
years. And I've always said since arriving that Cayman is very well prepared. We have very good systems in place. I think Danny Coleman at Hazard Management does a really excellent job in sort of marshalling the whole system. I think the regiment have shown their worth. I know there have been some naysayers about the regiment who are not convinced, but actually, I hope people have seen them out and about after one of these tropical storms, helping people in distress, clearing roads. They've been up to the Botanic Park and helped sort of clear up the damage there. So I think the regiment has done a really good job, and they've actually just done a really good job on the field hospital as well. I mean, the regiment played a key role in getting that field hospital back up and running. So again, we should be grateful to them there. So I think we're always well prepared. We always have the two Royal Navy ships in the region if we need to call on them. I remember you observed a beach landing some time ago.
My eyes and my throat remember that well. The sand was everywhere from that helicopter landing.
which give me a chance, as we're talking about helicopters, just to flag that we have put out a press release today, because we had a request from the Turks and Caicos Islands to support them. It's on a border security issue. I think everyone's familiar with the illegal migration problem. They get a lot of Haitian boats come in, but they don't have their own helicopter cover. And this is a particularly busy time of year. So as we now have two helicopters, and our both helicopters are fully operational, so we will have cover throughout in Cayman. We have sent a helicopter to Turks and Caicos for a couple of weeks. It'll probably go back again in January for a couple of weeks to support a fellow overseas territory with what is a really serious security issue. And, you know, I'm, as governor, I'm very proud that we're able to do that. Cayman has a long tradition of supporting the other overseas territories, supporting independent countries, and this is, you know, coming up to Christmas, I think this is a really nice gesture of support to one of our fellow overseas territories. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to say a huge thank you to our air operations unit, the police commissioner, and their teams for being willing to go. It's quite a significant burden we're placing on them to go and do this. But as ever, they just responded immediately and made the arrangements to go to Turks and Caicos.
Okay. Now, we do have a big event happening tomorrow in the court, something that, you know, has been very topical, something that directly involves you or your office, so to say, and that has to do with the use of your reserve power section under Section 81. The court case is happening tomorrow that was brought against you and the government, by Ms. Katina Anglin. I just want to get your thoughts ahead of the court case, you know.
To be honest with you, I don't know anything I can really say, Reshma, given that it's in court tomorrow. So obviously I have to be extremely careful about that. But I think the Attorney General's office, which is representing me, is fully prepared. But I shouldn't get into any comment on that at all. Let's let the courts do their job. That's what they're there for. And I think we'll have to wait and see what the outcome is.
All right. Thank
Good
you.
Try.
Rats. Well, you kind of technically gave me something I could work with, right? Not necessarily something I can really, you know, have a front page with, but we'll work with it. Thank right. you. Right. All right. Now, what we do have are more questions from the public, and I want to go to those questions that came in so that we can get those out of the way, and then we'll get to what I've been looking forward to talking about and a video that I want to show the public that you don't know that I have yet, but you'll find out just in a minute. So let's go first with the questions from the public. So we had a question come in asking, if someone is on a work permit and not yet vaccinated, and if that person has contracted the virus and subsequently completely healed, is it still mandatory for that person to be vaccinated? And I think that has to do with the immunity being built up after having contracted COVID and recovering.
It is true you do get some immunity from having contracted COVID, but I think the answer to that, again, it's not really for me, but the answer to that would, I think, be yes, because we are requiring people to be vaccinated.
Whether you've had COVID or not, you need to come in with a vaccine certificate. So I think the answer is yes.
All right. And another question, and we touched on this earlier, but I still want that it be asked. Why people over the age of 18 can't get the booster here yet?
They can.
Short answer,
which,
they can.
We're going to follow what the UK has just announced
the last couple of days. So everybody on our islands over 18 can now have the booster. I think they're starting it on Monday. Mm-hmm. The really key point is that we have reduced that gap from 6 months to 3 months. So if you got your second dose over 3 months ago, you are now eligible to come forward and get the booster. And my strong advice is to do that, because we do know that the immunity does wane somewhat, and what all the studies are showing is that the booster vaccine is incredibly effective at boosting your immunity, and your immunity after having had the booster is significantly higher than what your immunity would be after your second dose. So go and get that booster is the message.
All right, in case you didn't hear the message.
But thank you for giving me a chance to repeat it.
All right, so the video that I want to show, I think my director has it, the B-roll that we have with the governor actually training. Now, you are in the marathon on Sunday, am I right? And you're part of the relay team.
I don't want anyone to think I'm running the marathon, because I'm not running the full marathon, but I'm delighted to be
part of the Jasmine relay team. So there are four of us. Mm-hmm. So I will run a quarter marathon. So I'm doing 10, 11 kilometres, which is still quite a lot. It's longer than I normally... So
what's the training been like? I
run regularly anyway, because I build running into my daily routine. I mean, I'm very fortunate to be very close to a beach, mm-hmm. and I love to run on the beach every day. So I still do to the end, as far as you can go now. Unfortunately, where the beach erosion has meant my run has got a bit shorter, because I used to run further and I can't do that anymore. So I do that every day. So I feel I'm in pretty good shape to run 10, 11 kilometres. It'll be a bit tougher than normal, but actually running on the beach prepares you for running on the road, because it's actually quite hard on the beach.
I try to. It hurts your feet. It's so hot. But it feels nice when the water is running on your toes. Yeah. That's the best part about it.
I run near the water, which is where the sand is
harder. Mm-hmm. But I do sometimes run on the soft sand, which is really tough. But that's good for you.
Yeah.
That's really good for you. So
for the leg muscles.
Yeah. But I want to say Jasmine is a fantastic cause. I think they are a wonderful organisation on our islands, providing
help to people who really need it at the end of life. And it's a privilege for me to be running for them and to raise some funds for them, because can donate. There's a link on the marathon website, and some people have even sponsored me, which is nice. So if people want to sponsor charities we're raising funds for in the marathon, then visit the marathon website.
And I saw Dr. Lee doing some push-ups with you in one of
Dr.
the pictures.
Dr.
Lee's on the team. I got a note ahead of the show that was passed to me by one Andrel Harris, and I'm going to pass it to you. And that note is the record that he was on the relay team back in 2010.
Wow.
So he's giving you the time record.
2:53.
Yes, 2:53. Well, and that's a record to beat.
I think I can assure Andrel we won't be beating that record. I think our two colleagues, apart from Dr. Lee.
Dr. Lee and I might slow the rest of the team down, because our two colleagues look very fast and very fit.
Well, it's all for good.
It's all for good
cause. Yes. All right, Governor. Well, on that light note, we're at that point in time where we have to say goodnight.
Yes.
But I want to talk about 2022 before we wrap up and your expectations, because as you heard in the beginning of the show, this is our last show for the year and we'll be back in January. So I want to give you the opportunity to tell us a little about what we can expect coming up.
Well, I think two things. The first
I would say is I do remain incredibly optimistic and positive about the future for Cayman. I think we are gradually getting the tourism industry back up and running. We have an excellent product. It's a world beating. It's one of the best in the region. So my hope for 2022 is that we really get our tourism industry, back to what it was pre-pandemic, perhaps not with as many cruise visitors, but certainly for overnight stay visitors. And then secondly, next year is the Queen's Platinum Jubilee, 70 years on the throne, which is a absolutely incredible achievement. And she has given so many years of selfless service to the UK, to the overseas territories, to the Commonwealth, and to the world, in fact. So we will be marking that anniversary. You'll be getting an extra public holiday, which Cabinet agreed. So
yes.
3 to 6 June, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, we'll have a whole range of activities to celebrate the Queen's 70th anniversary. I know that there's real affection for her in Cayman, particularly the older generations, and I know people want to celebrate it. So we'll be having a concert, firework displays, there'll be the air show. There's real enthusiasm and ambition building up to try and bring some kind of air show back to Cayman, which used to be a hugely popular event many, many years ago. I think there'll be a car rally. I'll have the Queen's birthday party, the parade in front of Government House. So hopefully a really, really nice set of activities so we can just show our respect and admiration for Her Majesty the Queen. So I think there's a lot to look forward to in 2022, and I hope it's the year that we can all really put this COVID pandemic behind us.
hopefully, we're all looking forward to that. And plus, he said another holiday. Who can refuse another holiday? That's fantastic. All right, so on that note, we will say goodnight. And before we go, I'm going to leave you as per usual with my inspirational thought for today, and it comes from Bear Bryant. If you believe in yourself and have the dedication and pride and never quit, you'll be a winner. The price of victory is high, but so are the rewards. That's it for now, Cayman Islands. Thank you so much for staying here with us at the Resh Hour. On behalf of the Cayman Compass team, myself, Director Matthew Levy, have a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. We'll see you next time here on the Resh Hour. Good night.